Morning, it's good to see you. This side, pretty good. This side over here, let's all work a little harder, I guess. I'm glad that you come for church this morning. There's a lot of sickness going around. I don't think I was the one that spread it, but I'm glad that you're here. I'm feeling better. Thank you for those who told me to pray for me. Just a couple of announcements. Tuesday night, our zone mission rally at Sherman. We'll be taking the church van. It says in the bulletin we leave at 5, but that seems early.
It starts at 6:30.
Okay, 5:30.
So we'll leave at 5:30 from here if you want to ride the van to Sherman for that. Also, I did not mention last week again, but our Easter offering is coming up. What day is that going to be on, you think?
March.
On Easter, right? Yeah, that's what you go. Okay. April 9th. Yeah. It's on Easter. And our goal is $2,200. There are Easter offering envelopes, I believe, both entrances, and you can grab one of those and planning ahead. Also, our attendance goal for that day is 75. Now, if we're going to meet that based on us here today, we're each going to have to bring, you know, like 1.5 people to get us there. But I'm confident that we're going to come really close, even if we don't hit it, but it would be great if we exceeded that. Our services that morning, we're going to be meeting at 9:15 for hot breakfast, eggs cooked to order, the whole bit. So be here for that. Invite some friends. We'll talk more about that later. Service time on Easter is 10 o'clock, no evening service that week. Let us turn in our hymnals at this time to number 98. 98, and when you've got that, let's stand together. This is Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from?
My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
He will not let your foot slip.
He who watches over you will not slumber.
Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep.
The Lord watches over you.
The Lord is your shade on your right hand.
The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night.
The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. Amen. Let's stay standing as we begin singing this one.
Thank you.
I want to take a moment to recognize a new member to us. Kathy Hedden has been with us for a while now, and she has transferred her membership from Springfield First to our church. We're happy to have her. Kathy, don't embarrass you, but would you stand up, please? If you haven't gotten a chance to get to know Kathy, do so. She's very nice. I'm glad that we're very blessed to have both of you. Thank you. All right, let's have our ushers come at this time to receive our morning tithes and offerings. Father, we do thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to be together, to serve you, to worship you, to focus our attention on you at this time, Lord. What a great opportunity and a great blessing to be able to start our week off with songs and praises and prayers and the worship through your word. We thank you for that, Lord. And we want to worship you in our giving as well, Lord. May our giving reflect for each one of us our commitment to you. I pray that you would bless those that are participating. Help us to be truly generous as you have been to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Starting with verse 23 in your pew Bibles, it's page 1727. About the time there arose a great disturbance about the way, a silversmith named Demetrius, who made silver shrines of Artemis, brought in no little business from the craftsmen. He called them together along with the workmen in related trades and said, "Men, you know we receive a good income from this business. And you see and hear how this fellow Paul has convinced and led astray large number of people here in Ephesus, and in particularly the whole province of Asia. He says the man-made gods are no gods at all. There is a danger not only that our trade will lose its good name, but also that the temple of the great goddess Artemis will be discredited, and the goddess herself, who is worshipped throughout the province of Asia and the world, will be robbed of her divine majesty." When they heard this, they were furious and began shouting, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians!" Soon the whole city was in an uproar. The people seized Gaius, Aristarchus, Paul's traveling companion from Macedonia, and rushed as one man into the theater. Paul wanted to appear before the crowd, but the disciples would not let him. Even some of the officials of the province, friends of Paul, sent him a message begging him not to venture into the theater. The assembly was in confusion. Some were shouting one thing, some another. Some of the people did not even know why they were there. The Jews pushed Alexander to the front, and some of the crowd shouted instructions to him. He motioned for silence in order to make a defense before the people. But when they realized he was a Jew, they all shouted in unison for about 2 hours, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians." The city clerk quieted the crowd and said, "Men of Ephesus, doesn't all the world know that the city of Ephesus is the guardian of the temple of the great Artemis and of her image which fell from heaven? Therefore, since these facts are undeniable, you ought to be quiet and not do anything rash. You have brought these men here, though they have neither robbed temples nor blasphemed our goddess. If, then, Demetrius and his fellow craftsmen have a grievance against anybody, the courts are open and there are proconsuls. They can press charges. If there's anything further you want to bring up, it must be settled in a legal assembly. As it is, we are in danger of being charged with rioting because of today's events. In that case, we would not be able to account for this commotion, since there's no reason for it." After he had said this, he dismissed the assembly.
Let's stand again.
Thank you.
prayer at this time. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to meet with you in prayer. But Lord, we know that we aren't just speaking into the air. We aren't just saying things for our own perceived benefit, but that you hear us when we call to you. And we know that because you've said it in your word, Lord. We thank you that we can have the assurance that you hear us, that you attend to our prayers, Lord. Not in a way that is some sort of command structure where we speak the right way, say the right things, and you have to do what we say. Not that, Lord, just that you hear us, that you care about us, and you care about the things that concern us. And we thank you even more, Lord, that Jesus is sitting at your right hand, making intercession for us. Lord, when we consider the fact that Jesus Christ is praying for us to you, it should bring us great comfort and great encouragement to know, Lord, that we can know that we're loved, that we are taken care of. Lord, I know that you have something that you want to say to each one of us here today, Lord, because you are in a constant process of making us more like you, making us more like you, your vision for us, Lord. We thank you that you love us, you take us as we are, but you don't leave us like we are. You accept us in whatever condition we find that we are found in, but you don't intend to leave us in the condition in which you found us, Lord, and we thank you for that. Lord, there are numerous health issues that we're concerned about today. Think of this one baby in town that is a friend of Freddie's and found out that I have some connection to. I pray that you would be with that baby, Kenzie, today, that you would undertake for her special needs, be with Brianna, the mother, that you would encourage her, help her to learn to lean on you in this very difficult time. I pray that you would somehow, Lord, bring glory to your name through that situation. Lord, be with those of our number that are dealing with serious issues and seasonal issues. Lord, there are a number of us that are just not feeling our best, and I pray that you would help each one. Thank you. Byron this morning still dealing with the issues of his surgery. I pray that you would help him to get past this difficulty. I pray for Mark as he's continuing the recovery of the surgery he had. Lord, we lift Mary and Jean to you this morning, both struggling with some issues they're having. And there's just a number of us, Lord, that need a touch from you. Mostly, Lord, I pray for the ongoing work of our church, which is to proclaim your name, and to lift your name, and to teach your word. And I pray that you would help us to do that. As we look forward to the next 2 or 3 weeks, Lord, leading up to Easter, I pray that you would speak to each one of us and help us to take the ministry seriously, that we make plans on being part of the Easter offering, that your word would be spread throughout the world, that we would be inviting friends and family to our service that day, Lord, that we could have a glorious time of renewing and of celebrating your resurrection. Be with us now, Lord, as we study your word. Speak to our hearts through what you have for us today. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I was thinking that I wasn't going to have any coughing going on, and then I started singing. I probably shouldn't sing that much anyway, but that's for a different reason. Okay, anyway. We are, like Don said, on page 1727 in your Pew Bible. We're looking at Acts chapter 19, verses 23 through 41. And you may think, you know, in Acts a long time, aren't we about done with Acts? Well, I mean, we're getting there. But I can tell you, there's been a couple of passages lately that if I was going to skip, I would have skipped them. Just because, like, I find some of those to be interesting, but then I think, okay, well, what now? But I'm trusting God that he's got a plan for us. There's a reason it's in there.
Right.
And so we soldier on. And I hope it's okay. But it is going to be what it is, whether it's okay or not. All right. Well, anyway, what do you think of when I mentioned the phrase new math? Some of you are probably put in the mindset of trying to help your child do math problems in a way that the book prescribes, but that made little sense to you. If you are in a position of helping your grandkids, it's worse. The most recent version of new math would be Common Core. I remember once a few years ago working with kids after school in a scholastic bowl practice. I used to coach scholastic bowl, junior high scholastic bowl, did for almost every year I taught. So we're practicing for an upcoming match. And so everybody's got a pencil and paper. I gave them a math problem. In a math problem in scholastic bowl, you got 30 seconds to get it figured out, as long as the other team doesn't answer first. But you have a maximum of 30 seconds. So I give them the problem, and I happened to be walking around, and I noticed this one student making a grid that looked a lot like that, but more complicated. And so I stopped. I said, what are you doing? Oh, this is the lattice method. Yeah. I said, this is the way they said we should do it. I said, well, I mean, you can do it that way if you want to. I suppose you should for class. But if you do it that way in scholastic bowl, you're just going to be listening to the other team give answers. Because you're never going to make it that way. It does, it's not a fast way of doing it. I kind of think that I'm not a great advocate for the new math. Because the old math, it worked. I mean, I don't know. Sometimes I think the new math is like, you have sympathy for people that write history textbooks, and they're always making new history. What if you write math textbooks? I mean, you got to come up with something new to cause people to want to buy your book. So I think maybe that's part of what's going on there. I think Paul maybe would not have been a fan of the new math either. I think he was more of like a tried and true kind of guy. He found a system that worked for him, and he stuck with it, probably honing it along the way. In today's passage, we're seeing that Paul kind of gets a progress report of sorts on how his method's been working. Verse 23, let's take a look here, see if I can get that together. There we go. Verse 23 says, about that time there arose a great commotion about the way, for a certain man named Demetrius, a silversmith, who made silver shrines of Diana, brought no small profit to the craftsmen. He called them together with the workers of similar occupation and said, men, you know that we have our prosperity by this trade. Moreover, you see and hear that not only at Ephesus, but throughout almost all Asia, this Paul has persuaded and turned away many people, saying they are not gods which are made with hands. So not only is this trade of ours in danger of falling into disrepute, but also the temple of the great goddess Diana may be despised and her magnificence destroyed, whom all Asia and the world worship. So Paul had been at Ephesus for a little over 2 years. How had it been going? Well, Luke tells us that a great commotion arose about the way. He uses the same word here for Christianity that Jesus used of himself when Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. But he says it caused a great commotion. Some of us here are old enough to have, when we were younger, caused a commotion. Even when you're a kid, especially when you're a kid, I guess, and you're the one causing it. You were told not to cause a commotion. You didn't know what that meant. A commotion. I mean, you just knew that whatever it was you were doing, probably you shouldn't do that thing. It's funny, the words we use sometimes. But it was trouble. Whatever it was, whatever you want to describe it as, it was trouble. And Paul had caused it, according to these people. Ephesus was a well-known city in the ancient world. It had a river and a seaport, which helped it in that importance factor. The river, though, caused a lot of silting And they constantly had to work at it to keep it from silting in. The city's importance as a business center was actually waning by the time Paul had gotten there. Now, today, you could still go visit Ephesus, but it's been left so long not attending to that silting problem that it's not on the seacoast anymore. It's 6 miles inland. It's because of the way things work. The other thing that Ephesus had going for it was the Temple of Diana. That was a big deal. In fact, that temple was one of the 7 wonders of the world. And people came from all over the world to visit it. Those people brought with them what travelers typically bring: money. There was a lot of money to be made out of this temple. And this guy, Demetrius, is a silversmith. He was one who found out how to make money from the tourists that were there. He led a guild of artisans, and they made shrines, which were probably little replica temples of the big one, which was really big. And they sold those and made a lot of money doing it. And this guy, Demetrius, he was concerned about Paul because Paul was cutting into his business. In fact, he called a meeting of the guild to discuss it. What had Paul done? Well, he was just doing what he always did. He was teaching and preaching the gospel. He didn't come up with like the new math for what he was doing. He had a way, and he just did that way. He had his old standby message, and it didn't really matter that much whether it was Ephesus or Antioch. Well, he was just doing his thing. Now, it wasn't that he never changed. I mean, this Paul is the one that said, I become all things to all people, that by all means I might save some. So, I mean, he had some flexibility in the packaging of his message, but really he was just doing his thing. But this is what had Demetrius worried. He was concerned that Paul was convincing enough people about the truth of the gospel that his preaching was causing Demetrius's customer base to dwindle. He felt like if enough people listened to Paul and took his message to heart, they wouldn't want to buy his little shrines anymore. And Demetrius was arguing against Paul because Paul was affecting the business. That was really his bottom line. He tied his concern to a concern for Artemis. Well, it's not just that I don't want to make it, it's not just that I got a problem because we're not going to make as much money, fellas. I mean, we got to think about Artemis too. Okay, sure. I mean, that seems like a lot of businesses today. They're really concerned about causes. It's the cause of the month for a lot of these businesses. And it does seem to me like it's every month there's a new cause. But are they really concerned because they're true believers in the cause? Or have they just decided that's what's best for their bottom line? I mean, here in another 2 months, it's going to be a rainbow flag month again. And companies like BMW are going to change their logo for the month to have a little rainbow in their logo. Except, not in their Mideastern dealerships. So are they true believers, or are they just trying to make more money? Don't get me wrong, I'm okay for making money. But I think there's more to it than just, they're maybe questionable motives there. And I think that's what was going on here with Demetrius as well. I mean, I think the main thing was they're cutting into our business. And maybe he had remembered an incident we talked about last time where they had the big book burning. Paul cut into the business of the magic people, the people that were selling all these magic books and things. And it was having an effect. And Demetrius was upset because Paul said that man-made gods were not gods at all. You think? I mean, when Demetrius said that, and then said that this would damage their business and also the temple of Artemis, wasn't he sort of betraying a lack of faith? I mean, was he a true believer in Artemis or not? If Artemis is really a god, can't she take care of herself? You think? Let's look at the next passage in verse 28. When they heard this, they were full of wrath and cried out, saying, "Great is Diana of the Ephesians." So the whole city was filled with confusion and rushed into the theater with one accord. Having seized Gaius and Aristarchus, Macedonians, Paul's travel companions. And when Paul wanted to go into the people, the disciples would not allow him. Then some of the officials of Asia, who were his friends, sent to him pleading that he would not venture into the theater. Some therefore cried one thing and some another. For the assembly was confused, and most of them did not know why they had come together. And they drew Alexander out of the multitude, the Jews, putting him forward. And Alexander motioned with his hand and wanted to make his defense to the people. But when they found out that he was a Jew, all with one voice cried out for about 2 hours, "Great is Diana of the Ephesians." So, with this big argument of Demetrius's, he sort of touched the match to the kindling, and the fire took off. And they start chanting angrily, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians." Diana and Artemis are the same. Diana is a Roman name, Artemis is a Greek name. Same God. One thing led to another. Soon, the whole city is involved in, I suppose, a mostly peaceful protest. They are just rushing into this big theater, and this is a big outdoor arena that can hold about 25,000 people. On the way in, they grabbed a couple of Paul's assistants, and they take them in there. And Paul sees this, and what's he going to do? "Hey, I need to go in there and talk to those people." You got to give Paul credit. This guy is fearless. There's 25,000 people going to fill this thing up, all chanting, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians," and he's going to go in and preach to them. But Luke tells us that Paul had friends in high places. Verse 31 talks about officials. They were likely high priests in the worship of the emperor. But they were Paul's friends. That's interesting. I love Luke's description of the crowd. In the Greek, the word he uses for this crowd, this mob, is ecclesia. That might sound vaguely familiar to you. It's the same word that he uses for church. In both cases, it's an assembly, but he uses the word to sort of draw a stark contrast. The church is an ecclesia, but the church is not an unruly mob. The church is a group that's united in worship and obedience to Christ. Most of this group, most of this ecclesia, they had no idea why they were there. That's not hard for us to understand, I hope. If it is, I can only say you must not know very many people. There's a bunch of people on the street, and all of a sudden, they start all going this direction. I mean, let's break it down. I was standing out here doing the sign one day, last summer, and a carload of kids pulled up to the stop sign. And I happened to look over, and a couple of the kids in that car went. And you know what I did? I looked. You know what was there? Nothing. And they laughed and moved. We can't help ourselves. So there's all these people, and they're all going that way. And so then more and more people are like, "What's going on?" "I don't know. Let's go find out." So they're just all going. They don't know why they're there. And, you know, people just love the bandwagon. They don't even care that they don't know, it seems. Yet the social media is just chock full of bandwagon kind of cases, or causes, I should say. And it looks like, boy, everybody thinks a certain way. Don't assume that numbers include or indicate the strength of an idea, or that the people involved have any idea why they're there. Because often they don't. Apparently, there was a group of Jews that had gone in there, and they push Alexander forward. This poor sap was volunteered by his so-called friends. Get up there and say a word for us. I mean, there's 25,000 people in there, and they're all chanting, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians," and here comes this Jewish man. He puts his hand up. He would have been probably trying to make everybody understand, "I want you to know something. We're Jews. Those people are Christians. We're not the same." Well, the crowd, that didn't work. And so they just shouted him down, and they kept this chanting up for 2 hours. 2 hours of just chanting nonstop. Was that crowd, again, were they worried that Diana or Artemis couldn't really fight for herself? They're just a mob. They just were like, just the mob mentality took over, and they're just chanting over and over. Verse 35, there's a picture of that theater, by the way. When the city clerk had quieted the crowd, he said, "Men of Ephesus, what man is there who does not know that the city of the Ephesians is temple guardian of the great goddess Diana and of the image which fell down from Zeus? Therefore, since these things cannot be denied, you ought to be quiet and do nothing rashly. For you have brought these men here who are neither robbers of temples nor blasphemers of your goddess. Therefore, if Demetrius and his fellow craftsmen have a case against anyone, the courts are open and there are proconsuls. Let them bring charges against one another. But if you have any other inquiry to make, it shall be determined in the lawful assembly, for we are in danger of being called in question for today's uproar, there being no reason which we might give to account for this disorderly gathering." And when he said these things, he dismissed the assembly. So this, this city clerk speaks up, and I'm kind of reminded now of Gallio. If you don't remember who Gallio is, then later on you can just flip back through just a little bit and you'll find him there. He was the proconsul that effectively ruled that Christianity was a legally acceptable religion. This city clerk quieted the crowd and was able to speak some sense to them. He mentioned to them what they all held to be true, that the image of Diana fell down from Zeus. They all accepted that. It had come from the sky. And it may well have, because a lot of scholars think that the idol that they had of Diana was made from a meteorite. So that was their god. Ironically, this clerk acted almost like a defense lawyer for Paul. He tells Demetrius, if you feel you've got a cause, there are courts available for such thing. He should take the claims there. Why would the clerk have stood up for Paul like that? Well, I think in his mind, he was doing what Demetrius had done. He was looking out for his own best interests. In his case, he was thinking of the town and his position as part of the Roman Empire. The empire hated riots. They did not like civil unrest. That's one reason if you read the Passion story in Pilate, that was part of why the cowardly way he just gave Jesus up to those people. He didn't think Jesus was guilty. He said many times he was innocent. But he couldn't have a riot on his hands because the empire will find out, and then that's bad for everybody, especially him. This guy, though, this guy was also a living embodiment of Proverbs 21:1 that says, "The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. Like the rivers of water, he turns it wherever he wishes." Wouldn't it be great if we remembered that more often? I wonder, do you think if Paul had gone into that theater, that he could have calmed the crowd down? I mean, I don't think so. And the reason that I don't think so is because Demetrius, he was right. Paul was causing them great trouble. Christianity was on a collision course with their way of life. We learned a few weeks ago that Paul supported himself while ministering by being a tent maker. He surely didn't raise support for his ministry by selling coexist bumper stickers, because the message he was preaching was not one of coexisting. Warren Wiersbe says this: Paul did not arouse the opposition of the silversmiths by picketing the Temple of Diana or staging anti-idolatry rallies. All he did was to teach the truth daily and send out his converts to witness to the lost people of the city. As more and more people got converted, fewer and fewer customers were available. See, we don't need some sort of new math. We don't need the latest and greatest evangelism or outreach tool. We want people to come to Jesus. We want to see our loved ones and our friends saved. We could, try and come up with a fancy marketing tool, and I suppose that might get someone to come. But I feel like a lot of marketing involves making something look a lot better than it might be. It might be a detriment in the long run. See, we have what we have. We are what we are. But that's not what we're about. See, we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, the Lord of the universe. And we're trying to share him, or we should be. There are a lot of people there are a lot of people in the United States that can be persuaded to come and try a church based upon slick marketing. Now, there's a lot that can't, but there are some that can. But many of those same people then, well, they'll go to the next place when, you know, the next offer is appealing enough. See, the new math in this context would be some method of evangelism or outreach that's completely unnatural to you. Something that you look at and you think, I just don't even understand this. That would be the new math. And by unnatural, though, I don't mean uncomfortable. Because sometimes, frankly, we should be uncomfortable. It's okay to be uncomfortable sometimes. Too often, we just halt everything for that reason. Too many people are trying to avoid discomfort in every area of their life. And sometimes you just have to, you can't make progress without a little bit of discomfort. It's just the way things have to be. Inviting someone to church, that might be uncomfortable. Is that a reason not to do it? I put to you, it's not. I mean, it might be uncomfortable because you know what they might do? They might say, no. You might invite them, you might think, I got this. Okay, I'm gonna work up the nerve, I'm gonna say it just right, and I'm gonna get, and then they're like, eh, no. That might be uncomfortable. You know, speaking a word for the Lord, that might be uncomfortable. I mean, it might be. But I think that we could all, and by we, I mean me too, I think we could work on a simple method, not a new math kind of way, just a basic plan. If you had a plan to invite someone to church and or speak a word for the Lord every day of your life, if that was your plan, do you think that you might actually invite someone to church or speak a word for the Lord more often than you do now? I mean, it would be true for me. I think if you set a target like that and you ask God to help you, I mean, you might not hit the bullseye every time, but you certainly would increase your influence or your effectiveness for Christ because you'd be doing it more. I would be. If you're already doing that every day, well, then, I mean, hallelujah. That's awesome. But most of us probably less than that. The people we know, the people in our circle of influence, our micro-mission, the people that, when I say we know, could be people we know super well, like family. It could be people we know pretty well, like friends. It could be people we know because we know who they are, because they work at the gas station we always go to, or store, or restaurant, whatever. It could be like that. But those people, It could be they just might need someone that is willing to invite them to church multiple times. I don't know how you're wired, but here's how I'm wired. I get embarrassed too easily. Now, if you had known me for very long and seen me in a lot of settings, you might think, you don't ever seem like you're embarrassed. I'm a pretty good pretender. I mean, for one thing, when for 36 years now, my job is to stand up in front of a bunch of kids that don't have a filter and don't like think anything of offering helpful criticism. I've learned to take some things, but I do get embarrassed. And so like when I invite someone to church, especially I invite a friend to church, I've got somebody I'm going to invite for Easter. And I got to tell you, I'm like, in my own mind, I'm like Eeyore. I figure, well, they're probably not going to come. I'm going to not be Eeyore when I invite them. But I do feel like that sometimes. I'm like you. I'm embarrassed sometimes. I think, well, I mean, I've invited them before, and they didn't come. Yeah, well, guess what? I'm just going to invite them again. It might be that I just have to be that way. I have to be the person they know every once in a while is going to invite them to church. Or just they might need a friend like you who would offer a godly perspective on the topic at hand. I'm ashamed to say I missed an opportunity for this week, and I didn't even know I'd missed the opportunity until later. When I say it out loud, it's going to seem obvious, at least it does to me. It's going to seem obvious that it was an opportunity missed, and I shouldn't have missed it at the time. And I could give you excuses, but I'm not going to offer one because I shouldn't have done it. But someone that I have talked to many times, and every once in a while will say, I need to come to your church. I mean, they're saying that. I've invited them, yes, but they're still at the one of these days kind of a thing. we were talking, they're like, well, what's the good word? And I talked to them, we just chatted, and then later I thought, way to go, knucklehead. That was your opportunity to say something good for the Lord, right there. Well, but they might not ask the next time. Yeah, true, they might not. Yep. See, Paul had been changing the world, but you know what else I bet was true of Paul, and you don't read it in scriptures? I'll bet that Paul was somebody who had at least some people that maybe they're walking down the street, and they turn a corner, and there's Paul, and they're like, no. I know what he's going to say. I don't want to be around that guy. That's a possibility. That's a possibility. Does it seem that Paul let that bother him? No, it doesn't seem like it did. Do you think it ever did bother him? Yes, he's a person. Yes, it's. Listen, Satan is going to do everything in his power to make it easy to not invite people to church and to not speak a word in the Lord's name. He's going to make it easy. And then if we get ready to like cross the hurdle of being willing for things not to be easy, then he's going to do everything in his power to make it difficult for it to actually happen. Then he's going to start talking to you. Man, they're going to think you're dumb. They're going to think all this guy ever talks about is it a little different. You've already told them. You're bothering them. They've heard this. Why are you doing this again? I've been there. I'm there all the time. But that doesn't mean it's the wrong thing to do. The people that are in our life, they need a friend. They need us to be a friend. They need a friend who'll love them whatever they decide about Jesus. It's okay to have friends that are ungodly people. It's okay to have friends that you might think if your Christian friends saw that friend, they might wonder about you. Man, you hanging out with that person? Don't you know what they're like? Which sort of reminds me of several stories in the Gospels about Jesus. Mm-hmm. This guy's hanging out with all the wrong people. Yeah, because he's trying to make them into the right people. They're the wrong people now because they haven't made good choices. But he's just being their friend. That's what we should do. We have people, we got to decide what we believe. See, why do we come to church on a Sunday morning? We should ask that question. Why did I come to church today? Do I come because, well, I mean, I was always raised to come to church. Mom and Dad made me come when I was little, and so I just always come. That's true in my case. That's not why I come. That is a fact, though. I was raised to come. But is that why I come to church? Well, no. Do I come to church because this is my job? No. Because I was coming to church before it was my job, with as much regularity. So that's not true. Why do I come to church? Well, see, I come to church because I believe in the words of this book.
Amen.
I believe in the good news, and I believe in the bad news that's contained herein. I believe that for me, if I quit coming to church, if I started being careless about the things of God, if I started living in a way that was displeasing to Him, I would find myself in real danger of breaking complete relationship with Him. And I just have read enough to know that that means there would come a day where I might line up in the correct line, but when I got to the front of the line, Jesus would say, you need to be in that one. So this is the sheep. You're in the goat line. I don't want to be in that line. I want to be in this line. That's why I come. So now I have to ask myself, well, what about the people that I supposedly care about? Yeah, but see, Russ, they don't want to know. Okay. I'm like critical of myself. I'm not critical of you. I don't know you guys nearly as well as I know myself, but I can tell you this. I've told all sorts of people things they didn't want to hear once more time. It's the end of college basketball season. I've told any number of people about Indiana basketball. They didn't care. They didn't want to hear it. I didn't care. I said it anyway. I was willing to for that. When I was in college, at Olivet, I went to Olivet before I went to IU. When I was at Olivet, most of my friends that were there, most of the people that I ended up knowing, were from other states other than Indiana. I didn't care that they thought I believed that Indiana was better. I'd tell them any number of times. I still tell people things like that. I think I used that phrase this week. They were talking, I forget where I was. Somebody said something about some person, and I was like, oh, that famous Hoosier. I say that stuff all the time. I don't care if it offends people. I mean, I care, but I don't really care. I figured if it offends them, it's their problem. I'm not trying to be offensive. If I'm willing to be that way, why aren't I more willing for things that are going to matter 1,000 years from now? Because, you know, I hope my team wins today and then next week and then the weekend after that. But if they don't, or even if they do, 1,000 years from now, it won't matter.
Really?
This stuff will matter.
Right.
It don't matter to people that I say I care about. See, it's not the new math. It's just the same gospel story. It's Jesus' story. It's Paul's story. And if we claim the name of Christ, it should be our story. We have a goal on Easter of 75 people being in church with us. I'm going to tell you right now, if none of us here today do any more than we don't invite people, we just sort of pray and hope, it won't happen. I really think so. Well, God can't, what you pray? And if you pray and you say, Lord, help someone to convince that person to come to church, God's going to say, hey, I got an idea. How about you? You got to be the answer to your own prayer in that stuff. So I think that we have to be responsible. We have to take responsibility for that. We have to help people. And yeah, they might say no. Or, you know what else? They might say yes, and then not come. That's kind of a bummer. That's okay. That's okay. To do that, though, we've got a couple of tools for you. Rachel's made up some things that we're going to pass out to you, that you can look at that, and it's got some information for you. And Kathy has made up some sheets that are both entryways that you can take that are actually handouts as you invite someone. It's got information on there. So this one that is coming around now is for you. That one is to give to people. And so you can take some of both. And then on March 30th, that's a Thursday, we're going to meet here at 6 o'clock, and we're going to go around the neighborhood handing out more of those invitations. Okay? So March 30th, 6 o'clock, we're going to walk around handing out those things. If that idea makes you nervous, you can join me. I'm nervous about it too. We can be honest. But it'd be great if we got some people that were ready to come to church, that just needed God to send someone to them. We can be the answer to that prayer. Okay? So again, the other things are at the door. Take some of those. Don't take 50 if you're only going to hand out 3. But take more than you think you'll hand out so that you'll have them. And we'll have more. Yeah. Okay? Well, I hope that God blesses our efforts and blesses us in our efforts. And I just, every time you speak a word for Him and you're not hauled off to jail or beaten up, probably it feels like a victory. And it should encourage you for the next time. And every time you invite someone to church and they don't say, "How dare you? I can't believe you would ever do such a thing." And, it probably feels like a victory. So let's pray for boldness. You're not Paul, neither am I. But we're us. Paul's not here. It's us. So let's pray that God will encourage us as we endeavor to obey His command to evangelize. Father, thank You for this day. Thank You for these good people that have come today, Lord. Speak to each one. Help us even now to be thinking of people that we could invite to church. People that we might see on our own prayer list, Lord. People that would say this is their church, but we just don't see them very often. Let's start with them and reach out to them. And then let's go to our friends and family that we know are not involved in any church. Let's be friends and friendly to people, Lord, that we can be a witness for You. Help us to be winning and winsome in our ways so that we aren't personally offensive, even if the message of the gospel may be offensive. Bless our efforts, Lord. We want to live and work for You. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank You for coming today. Dismissed.